Tejanotimes.com. Tejanotimes.com.
A mí me dicen el alacrán porque yo soy de la Colorada. A mí me dicen el alacrán porque yo soy de la Colorada. Y si me encuentro con un caimán, lo dejo tieso de una picada. Y si me encuentro con un caimán, lo dejo tieso de una picada. Antes de anoche me emborraché con un barril de cerveza fría. Antes de anoche me emborraché con un barril de cerveza fría. En la mañana que desperté, andaba Elena, Julia y María. En la mañana que desperté, andaba Elena, Julia y María.
TejanoTimes.com.
Make it conjunto, carnal. Here we go.
TejanoTimes.com.
TejanoTimes.com. DJ Alacrán. DJ Alacrán.
Thank you.
raza, ¿cómo está toda mi palomía? ¿Cómo está mi clica? From the beautiful Central Valley, coming to you live. Right here on TejanoTimes.com. You're listening to Elliot Verbo, Los Bolíos Subconjunto. Muchachos Alegres, one of my favorite poquitas of all time, baby. Great show for y'all today.
Bueno, lo verás.
Quiero que sepas. I want you to know, baby. I hope you guys are having a great weekend. And I'm about to make it a little bit better today.
Bueno, lo verás.
Aquí en el cantón, live interview all the way from Alhambra, Califas. Mi compadre, mi carnalito, great musician, Mr. Elliot Verbo, from Bolillo y su conjunto. I know he's very popular around the state here in Califas. And if you haven't heard about him, you are today. Saludos. Está bonito, está desgraciado. ¿Cómo estamos, carnal? Aquí lo tengo.
I'm good. Alacrán, what's up?
Aquí estamos,
bro. I want to say hello, Central Valley. And give some shout-outs. Definitely, Los Hooligans, Conjunto Califas, and Texas Funk. And all my friends over there, Selma, Parlier, and Fresno. Madeira, and it's good to be here.
Well, you know what, man? Let me tell you something. It's great to have you on the air. I've been wanting to do this for a while. Finally got the opportunity, and I would like to thank you for taking the time and joining the Alacrán Show. It's been a while since I saw you. Where was it at, Elliot? Oh, at the benefit for Israel Trevino.
Fresno.
Yeah, we talked a little bit and stuff like that. I think that was probably the start of the beginning of my show. And finally, I got it, and aquí estamos. And dije, no, as soon as I get the opportunity, I'm going to get my compadre on the air. You know what, and to start off things, and we didn't talk about this, something that I've been wanting to ask you. How did Elliot Verbo get interested in conjunto music? I know you play a lot of instruments, man. I've seen you jam.
Yeah. That's a long story. I mean, people will usually ask me that at a show or a party, and they're not really prepared for how long it's going to take for me to tell that story, so... I'm glad I have a few moments to share that.
Oh, absolutely. Usted échele, échele ganas. We got time right here.
We got time? Oh, okay.
No, and if we run out of time, sabes que I'll let you know, man. Pero no, we're doing good. We're doing good. Usted échele ganas. I want to hear.
Well, I grew up in Southern Orange County, and I was just basically like a surfer boy, a skater, white boy, you know, basically. And then I started getting into music, and I wanted to play the blues and play the blues guitar like Robert Johnson and do all this, you know, folk blues and slide guitar. And then, you know, I got into like Woody Guthrie and I wanted to play the guitar, and I kind of got a guitar and kind of taught myself how to, learned a couple chords from a friend and started messing around with that. Got into music and like rock music and then later on, when I was about almost finished with high school, I was like either going to be an artist or I thought, well, I'll either be an artist or a musician. And I wasn't very good at drawing. And like my friend, he was like a lot better than me. So I was like, maybe I'm not as talented on this. So I started going towards music, and then I got really into jazz, and I wanted to be a jazz piano player. And I was listening to like Coltrane and Thelonious Monk and Miles Davis. And then I would listen to this radio station here out of Long Beach called 88.1 KLON. And then it turns out that I would listen on Friday nights, and then on Friday nights they had a show called Jazz on the Latin Side by Mr. Jose Riso. And then he would play all the Joe Cuba and Tito Puente and all the, you know, more like instrumental Latin jazz. Right. But I really got like fascinated with the sound and you know, the rhythm, and I got kind of into Latin jazz. And then from there I got into salsa, and there was another station that I would listen to called KPFK, and then they would had a show on Saturday night, and I would listen to that show. And then I got into more like salsa, where it's dance music and there's like there's a singer and a song, and they sing inspiraciones, and I just became fascinated by that. And then I went off to college. I went to the California Institute of the Arts to study jazz piano.
Wow.
And pretty much by the time I got there, and you know, after like the first year, I was like, I don't know if I want to be a jazz musician, because it's just kind of not really a happening music. I mean, I was feeling like more like I wanted to play Latin music more and like, you know, do salsa. So during my time there, my mentor, my piano teacher, David Roitstein, he was running a student band that played salsa, because he was from Miami and he was like steeped in the salsa scene. And I wanted to do it really bad. But he was the piano player, so I decided to be a singer. And so I auditioned, and I ended up being one of the singers. And one of my jobs was to, you know, write the music for the band, the full, you know, two trumpets, two trombones, bass, piano. And then I would just, whatever the singer was doing on the record, I would just learn it and sing exactly what that was. And it was a really good education. Eventually, when I got out of school, I started playing salsa piano, like more like full time. And I was basically using all the things that I learned as a jazz musician, but just, you know, applying it to salsa. And so during this time when I was at school, I met my friend Otonio Lujan. His dad, he was at the school to be an artist, and I was there to study music. Otonio's dad was a famous Chicano artist named Magu, Gilbert Lujan. Mm-hmm. And while I was there, Otonio was the head of the Chicano Student Union. And he was also in my Chicano studies class. And so we were kind of like friends. And then he had a Day of the Dead event, and he brought he was studying the accordion, and he brought his teacher's group to the school to play. And they had accordion, bajo sexto, and bass. And then I was in charge of providing the sound system through the music school. And then we kind of just started talking, and I became kind of fascinated with, because I was like, believe it or not, I was a little bit homesick. And even though I wasn't very far away from where I lived, like in the Santa Ana area, I was way up, you know, I was up in Valencia near Magic Mountain.
Right, right.
But it's a very like cookie cutter kind of homogenous area. And so when I was hearing, you know, Mexican, basically, quote unquote, Mexican music, and there's some students have brought mariachis to the school and this and that, I was feeling more and more like a deep connection to it. And then I once I started hanging out with Otonio, he was like, yeah, man, you got to play the bajo sexto. And I was like, oh, yeah, like I've seen that before, but like I tried to play it, but I was like, this is like, it's not a guitar. And so I was really confused. And he's like, yeah. He's like, you know, come with me to my teacher and he'll teach you how to play the bajo sexto. Because I was just playing the guitar with him, you know, and I was, and it's just not, you know. Yeah. We're doing all this like Los Alegres, just all day, all of Los Alegres, Veteran. So I went to his teacher.
Prior to that, were you familiar with this music, or was that the first time you've been introduced to it?
No, I mean, it was around me, I mean, when I was growing up, but, you know, it was like,
right, right.
You know, when you're a kid, you're like, I don't want to listen to that.
Right.
You're like, I want to listen to Pink Floyd and, you know, right. The Grateful Dead and Led Zeppelin.
Right.
But then, you know, as I progressed more in my musical tastes and education, I got like a really strong respect for working musicians, you know, like people that provided dance music for like a utilitarian purpose, as opposed, you know, to, so, you know, someone who doesn't consider their audience, or, you know, like heady jazz, like
right.
That really not a lot of people listen to, that music that people don't dance to, and they're just intellectual about it and all that stuff. And that's kind of what jazz has become. It's
right.
it's not a dance music anymore. So it's basically, it's kind of more like a college kind of listening music.
Sure, you know, you get a glass of whiskey and turn on a cigar and sit back and just, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Like my friend was like, "Oh yeah, I only listen to jazz like on a rainy day."
Yeah.
But I mean, I saw musicians on the street, you know, like in Boyle Heights and in Santa Ana, like, and they, you know. They were like standing out on the street and people would come and hire them, and they would, you know, go to a party and, you know, provide that music that people wanted to hear. And I was like, that's what I want to do. You know, like I want to be like a working musician that is, you know, connected to a community. And that's not what jazz is. I mean, salsa is more like that, and, you know, and of course, ranchera music is definitely like that. So,
right.
After, you know, during when me and Otonio were at school, then we formed Conjunto Los Pochos, and then
right.
Like in 1996, Otonio had gone to see Flaco Jimenez out here in Santa Monica.
Which is coincidentally his birthday today. Happy birthday, Flaco.
Yeah, yeah. Happy birthday, Flaco. I met Flaco over at Taste of Texas, the old Taste of Texas in Covina one night. And, and that's a whole other story.
Yeah. Well.
So, In 1996, I went to Texas for the first time with the group. We all went as a group, and we were just young, and like, we just went out there. Like, I was staying at someone's house, you know,
right.
and some other people in the group had, they're good at making connections and hooking it up. So, we met Sandy Sanchez, and Sandy Sanchez got us in his van and like drove us all over San Antonio.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we were following him around to his gigs and like just hanging out and having a good time, and met all kinds of people. Met Nick Villarreal and Henry Zimmerly.
Hombre, todos los vatos conjunto pesados out there, huh?
Yeah, man. And like, I didn't know. The only thing that I knew about was like Ramon Ayala and like Flaco Jimenez. And that was
the extent of your knowledge.
That was the extent of, yeah, like Los Tigres and that other group from Tijuana.
Uh-huh.
Los Tucanes.
Los Tucanes, okay, yeah.
Yeah, so that's what I knew about the music, right? And so then when I got to Texas and I heard everyone, you know, I was like, oh, this is like...
This is what it's all about.
This is a different way of playing. It uses basically the same instruments, playing the same songs, but it's, you know, performance practice is different.
Right.
You know, the way people dance is different.
Yes.
You know, the weather is different. The food is different. You know, it's like just, it's a whole, you know, it's like going to another country.
Yes.
So
exactly.
Got real into it, you know, and just really, especially Sandy Sanchez, like hearing him. And I didn't know as much about the diatonic button accordion as I know now. So I was like, how is he even able to do that on a three-row Hohner, like the things that he does and the chords that he plays? And
right.
It's like a whole different, you know, deal, you know, it's like.
Which is very, very difficult. Playing the accordion is very difficult.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yeah, I would see, at that time I was just playing the bajo sexto.
Right.
We, I think we were hanging out with Flaco's first drummer, and I think he's passed away, but he had a nice house, and he used to have a party every year after the Conjunto Fest. And so we were there at the party. He's got a big old, like, he's got like an acre or something. So this is a big old barbecue and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And Mingo Saldivar was there, and he used to play at that little party.
Wow.
It was like Conjunto Fest party. And, you know, I had a couple people show me a couple things on the bajo sexto, you know, to like to expand on my knowledge of just three chords. Like the norteños, when they teach you, they just say primera, segunda, tercera, just three chords. But the Tejano started showing me more things, like doing turnarounds and adding extra chords and extra flavor. And like how they execute their music, how they play their music, and I started getting a little more knowledge, you know, finding out awesome groups like that people don't really. I ask a lot of people about Rams and the Pioneers, and a lot of people don't know about Rams and the Pioneers, but. I saw Rams over there in a place, and I was just blown away at the level of their musicianship and the execution. You know, three, like Bernal, like Estilo Bernal, like three part harmony, and adding a lot of chords. And so then I played bajo sexto with Los Pochos for many years. We made two CDs. We went all over the place, upstate New York, and me and Antonio, just on our own. We were part of a theater production. We went to Canada. We went to Austin. We were on Austin City Limits. We went all over the place, all over the country. And then Otonio retired. He started having his family. He had a couple children and just got, you know, busy with
life,
being in their lives more and that whole thing. We would play Tardeadas down here at Post 1944, and we do a Sunday dance to play four sets, you know, and we run the door, do raffles, and it was a great time.
Hey, let's play a song from that era, Los Pochos.
You're gonna play Margie's?
Yeah, I'm gonna play Margie's, just so that the people can see what you're talking about.
Cool. Yeah, this is when I was living in City Terrace, and there was two different bars.
Where the people are friendly, where the
only serves beer.
Uh huh.
And then El Tropico was another bar over in Boyle Heights. And it was like a crazy bar. Like they would ask us to play there. They loved us. But the owner said, I can't pay you in money. I can only pay you in liquor.
You. So, hey, well, you know what? Let's listen to the song and then you tell us the story behind it.
Okay.
I'm a
You will. No, no, no. Let me tell you something. I really enjoy this song. So who this song talking about?
Well, it's about these two different bars that I used to go to. One, Margie's was like a beer bar, the kind of bar that only serves beer. And that was like a chill place. It was close to where I was staying. But then El Tropico was like this crazy bar in Boyle Heights. And the owner, Hector, he used to have us come play on Sundays, but then he would tell us, I can only pay you in liquor. So I used to have all kinds of antics, and we used to get crazy over there.
You didn't complain too much about that type of thing.
No, I mean,
right?
At the time, I was pretty happy about it, but I was a lot younger, you know?
Yeah. Hey, that'll work.
So yeah. It's like, over at El Tropico, he used to have, like, dancers, and, you know, like, they used to do anything they could do to make money over there. So there was always something going on over there.
Let me ask you another question. Did you know Spanish, or did you learn Spanish to sing?
I mean, I've been slowly putting the pieces together. I mean, I could like go when I was in Mexico. I mean, I could get around and pretty much get what I wanted, but I don't think that I could have like a full conversation in Spanish.
I know that your wife is Mexican, correct?
Yeah, well, it's more like Chicana.
Chicana.
I wouldn't consider her Mexican.
Oh, okay. But what I'm trying to say is that I'm sure that her Spanish is, you've learned a lot from her.
No, my wife doesn't speak Spanish.
Not that much, huh?
No,
you probably speak more Spanish than she does.
I do. Yeah, her parents decided that she wasn't going to speak Spanish.
Wow. Yeah.
Because that, you know, in the 60s and 70s, you know, it was like they just were, you know, they just decided that it was going to be English.
Yeah, that's the way it was back then. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and
she's from Madera.
Yeah, she's from this neck of the woods.
Yeah, and she you know, she worked, and she worked in pistachios, and her father was ran the nursery at a pistachio farm and everything, and
yeah.
But as far as my Spanish is concerned, I mean, every day I'm trying to, you know, get more and more, you know what I mean? I do have times where I do speak it, but then there's other times where I can't really understand, like I'm lost in the conversation because it's just need more practice on that.
Yeah. That's all it is, man. Just practice.
I wouldn't say that I'm a fluent Spanish speaker, but I definitely, like I would like to be. I'm trying to get on the road. Like there's times, like if there's no one around that speaks English, then I'll start to, you know, I can participate in a conversation, but at some point I get lost. Yeah. It's mostly because I can't understand. Like it's coming out so fast that I can't. Like, I don't have time to process it, you know, just get it.
You know what? I'm going to play this this other song that I really enjoy, really like. It's called...
Which one?
Doble Pagarás.
Tony De La Rosa.
Yes. Who's your vocals, right?
Yep, this is... Yeah. I tried to do a transcription of what Tony... I think I got about maybe 60%. What he's doing.
Let's check it out.
No quiero nada contigo. Ya no quiero más.
hecho contigo.
You're tuned in to DJ Alacran right here on TejanoTimes.com. We got mi compadre Elliot Variable from Bolio y su conjunto. Aquí lo tenemos all the way from Alhambra, California. This is a beautiful city down south. And he's sharing some stories with us, stories that I've never heard before. And I hope you guys are enjoying the show. ¿Verdad que sí, bro? ¿Cómo estamos? How's the weather over there right now?
It's good. It's been raining. I love the rain. So,
yeah, you know what? It's been pouring over here, también. Yeah, the Wheatley River has been, Kings Canyon River has been overflowing. They had to evacuate all kinds of people from the shore there, from the riverfront. And so, a ver cómo. Hopefully, everybody stays safe out there. Pero mira,
yeah,
let me ask you about the band members on this CD. The last song that I played. And in a couple minutes, I'll play another one that's one of my favorites. And you got it. Well, most of them, I really enjoyed them. But who's the band members on this particular CD?
On that CD, it's Lorenzo Martinez on bass, Lencho. And Lencho is all over the place. He played drums with the Tex-Maniacs, Flaco Jimenez.
Oh,
he
wow.
plays guitarrón, bass, fihuela, and all that.
Wow.
So he's been my friend for many years. On the drums is Richard Flores. Richard played with Sonny and the Sunliners back in the day, and with Juan Chapa. No, wait. I know he played with Sonny and the Sunliners, and Danny, the bajo sexto player, Danny Flores. He played with the Juan Chapa group.
So they're originally from Texas, is that right?
All those guys, they're all from San Antonio.
You. Yeah, I knew that had to be it, man, because you guys sounded bad dudes, man. When you guys, I've seen you guys perform. I've seen a lot of videos, and man, you guys really jam, really cantas con corazón.
You know, when you live here in LA, it's like you're gonna try to find some people and explain to them what conjunto, what Tejano music is. I mean,
yeah,
those guys were playing this music years and years and years before I was, so. I met them through, you know, going to the dances and trying to be a musician and stuff, because they were playing with other groups and other, you know. So when I was looking for people to play with after Los Pochos, you know, I decided to pick up the accordion and do my own thing.
So you picked up the accordion and you say, you know what? I want to play. I want to learn this.
Yeah.
Now, did it come easy for you? Since, I mean, you've
definitely
already.
Definitely not.
Did you have somebody there telling you this is how you do it? This is what you got to learn first?
No, I did not. Wow. So, when I was at Rosedale Park, I think in 1998 or no. Had to have been later than that. Rosedale Park, San Antonio, May, like, 2005 or something. There was a guy selling a book there. And he's a guy who's an accordion teacher.
Okay.
And I can't remember his name. But
he wasn't...
Joe... I'll think of his name, but he was selling a book. And in the book, he had a method, you know, to learn the GCF button accordion.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing, I mean, I've seen a lot of books, and none of them make any sense. But the one thing that he had on the last page was the reason that I bought the book. And the thing that he had on the last page was a full, you know, visual of all the notes pulling out and all the notes pushing in. Because when you push and pull on the three-row diatonic button accordion, the notes are different. Sound.
Yes.
And that's one of the things that makes it really hard, confusing, complicated to play.
Yeah, you need the right timing to push and then to bring it back in. Yeah, it's...
Right. So at first, mostly when you're learning, you just only pull out, because if you start pushing and pulling, it's so confusing that it's hard to progress. But what I saw, when I saw all the notes, you know, listed there, like as a visual, the button board pulling out and then on the other side pushing in, I said, well, I can use my knowledge that I have, you know, from having a degree, Bachelor of Fine Arts in jazz piano, to get the scales, you know, to connect the dots, literally, you know, to play connect the dots with the scales, C, the D major scale, the G major scale, and the F major scale. And then I said, well, I can, you know, because I have this, now I can kind of start on my own. And so I got a Panther, like a real cheap box, you know, like $500 or $600.
Yeah, the beginner's one, the beginner's accordion, yeah.
Right. And I just started doing it because I really wanted to do it. The other thing is that because I played bajo sexto and I had been listening to the music for many, many years, so I know how it's supposed to sound. I know which accordion players that I want to listen to.
Right.
And I know how I want it to sound. And I started going. I learned a lot of things.
Well, it's like a harmonica, man. I mean, isn't it the same concept?
It's having three harmonicas in a box.
Yeah.
One harmonica in F, one harmonica in C, and one harmonica in G. So I made, you know, I did what I could to start playing the music, and then later on, I started more and more, like the more and more that I play, the more and more I try to play exactly what I'm hearing, exactly the right way, you know, with the right accordion in the right key, and, you know, hitting all the same exact notes. It takes a while. I mean, you got to start with the scales, and then after you get the scales, then you can start moving around and figuring stuff out. I'm still learning. I mean, I started trying to teach someone a Totonilco by Tony De La Rosa, and then when I started trying to teach it to them, I started listening to it, and the more I listened to it, the more I realized that I wasn't playing exactly what's on it.
You know what? And it's interesting you say that, because I've heard musicians, accordionists, play a polka, and then on top of that, they're still not happy because they always want to learn more. They learn from another musician, and they say, "Man, I thought I was doing it right," and suddenly I realized that I could add more to it. I could, you know, there was a little something that was missing in there. And yeah. and it's interesting how I'm not an accordionist, obviously, but when I listen to an accordion player, I can tell, I mean, the difference between different accordionists right away because of their style. And if a lot of times it's not that they're making mistakes out there. It's just they're tweaking it. They're making it a little bit different than the original huapango or polka or any song for that matter.
My what I believe in and my concept is, like, for instance, if you go to the Conjunto Fest, whatever Conjunto Fest that you go to, you're going to hear a Totonilco like 8 times in one day.
Yeah.
And everyone puts their own personality into it, you know, and their own little style. And I love that. That's what's great about this music.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's definitely. It's like I was telling Chris Guzman from Conjunto Firme. You know, I was telling him that you know, that it, the reason it's a great thing is because you can just know who they are, who's playing, just by the style they're bringing out of the accordion.
Yeah.
And I think that that combination, it's amazing. It's great.
So that's another, it goes back to like my motivations, like why I want to do this. And I started to like music that came out of a very strong tradition. And that's one of the things that I love about conjunto music, is it's comes out of such a strong stream of elders, you know, that showed us the way. So once I learned exactly, like I'm almost done, but I went back to Tony de la Rosa in that, what everyone thinks is so easy, a Totonilco, like in the 1950s. And once I get that note for note, then I'll feel more comfortable about doing it my way.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And I guess that's that applies to everything. Learn how to do it right. Learn how to do it the way it's supposed to be. And then you can start adding your own flavor.
Exactly. I mean, I feel like there's a lot of people out there that aren't interested in that, and you know, they don't like. I feel like they fall by the wayside. You know what I mean? Like the reason I'm doing this is like, after all these years and having all these expectations, whatever. I'm going to be this. I'm going to be that. You know, I'm going to be a jazz star or whatever. Like, I just want to, like, I mean, I could still play jazz. And the thing is that it's how I feel about it, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
It's how I feel about it now.
This next song that I want to play, Swinging Doors. Tell me a little bit about it.
I know this song from Mingo Saldívar.
Okay.
And I love Mingo. Like, Mingo comes from the Tony de la Rosa, like, sure, style of playing, where it's like, yeah, you sing and play at the same time.
Yeah.
And it's like you have that the masa is like going the whole time, you know. But he's singing.
Yeah.
And I mean, the groove, I mean, he's so in the pocket. So, and then also I love that he sang country music so well.
Yeah, right? He did. Yeah.
La Rueda Fuego, and he's just so put his own,
the Mexican Cajun cumbia, nombre,
I loved Mingo so much. Like, that's like one of the things that really drew me into Tejano conjunto music, is that it's such an American music.
Sure.
It's like
it was born in America, and it was, you know, and
it's a little different than Norteño, because it's like Norteños, they don't do all that extra.
Right.
You know, they don't play any country music. I mean, they don't play polkas.
They're cousins. I mean, Norteño, you know, they developed their style in northern Mexico. And of course, and conjunto, they give it their own flavor. And it's interesting, you know, that I just learned this not too long ago, because I was listening to my dad's old records. And I had a record of Tony La Rosa, and I also had one of Rubén Vela, which, oh, yeah. I mean, big fan of Rubén Vela. And I noticed, I was playing it the other day, and I noticed that the beat, the tempo was a lot faster. Boom, 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 a lot faster.
Yeah, the old days.
And I listened to it, to the same song today, and I noticed that the tempo's a little bit slower, more calmed down and stuff. And so, and I really didn't pay too much attention to it. I figured, well, maybe that was just a style, and then slowly started evolving to slower. But no, that I learned that the reason that they started slowing the tempo was because of Tony La Rosa. Tony La Rosa was the father of that, the one, yes, that said, hey, you know what, let's slow it down. You know, the Texas weather, as we all know, is extremely,
exactly,
humid. And
exactly.
and in the polka in Germany, in Europe, it stands, you know, they don't slide their feet. They kind of like bounce a little bit, you know.
They're hopping around.
And that's how, and I heard that that's, Dad told me back in the day, that's the way people were dancing polkas here in Texas also. Yeah. However, due to the weather, The humidity and everybody's sweating, everybody's getting tired. Because back then, the dances were made in el patio, out in the porches, and, you know, just a slab of cement outside. And so they started sliding their feet instead of just stomping around. And I go, wow, that's interesting. But, yeah, and that's how it started developing and evolving into the music, the conjunto style of today. Wow.
Yeah, Tony De La Rosa, he was influenced by, like, Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys.
Wow.
And like, Hank Williams. And then, you know, like, Mingo, you could hear that, you know, the Cajun and the country in there. And that was for me, you know. Like, I knew it was more and more for me, you know. When I was at Rosedale walking through the parking lot, you know, I see this bumper sticker on someone's car that says, Puro Pinche Blues.
Yeah.
And I was like, I know the blues. Like I'm steeped in the blues, you know, from Robert Johnson. And, you know, when I was in high school, like, I got so hardcore into the blues, you know. And I was thinking, well, this is more in my, like, the things that I know. You know, you get a little country, a little blues, a little Cajun in there.
It's interesting you're saying that because one time I was talking to Charlie Hetrick, and he was the bass player for Esteban Jordan for many years, for about 30 years, I think. And I had the honor of meeting them one time. They were friends of the family, or Esteban was. And they stopped in Parlier, talked to my uncle, and Dad was there, and I was there, and Charlie was there, and Bonifacio Jordan was there. And so... Charlie, what's your style of music? How'd you end up with the stem? He goes, no, man, I play rock and roll, man. That's my thing, hard rock. And he says, you know, I love rock. And, you know, he had long hair, white guy, tall, white, skinny guy. He looked like a rocker, man. And I said, wow, so how'd you end up? Why are you playing a conjunto with the stem? He says, let me tell you something, Henry. He says, if it would have been any other type of music, I don't think I could do it. But playing this jamming with Esteban, you know, it keeps me busy. It makes me do what I want to do on the bass because of style of music that he plays. He throws in some jazz, some rock in there, some, you know, country. I mean, and exactly what you're telling me right now. And I say, wow, yeah, he says, you know what? You got to keep up. You got to keep your skills going with playing this type of music. And I never realized that, but yeah, you know, it's interesting. You just mentioned it.
Yeah. I mean, Steve Jordan, I mean, what blew me away about him, because I come from the salsa world, Cuban music and Puerto Rican music. He's the only Tejano accordion player pretty much that I've ever heard that actually knows how to play like Cuban music. Salsa. Whatever they call it, son, salsa.
Yeah.
Like he had, and that's a whole other story because I know a guy from Cuba that used to live in Detroit, and Steve Jordan used to open for his Cuban group.
Yeah.
Wow. And he used to tell me that's how Steve Jordan learned how to play, by watching me and my Cuban musicians play the real salsa. You know.
No, and Steve he said. One time we were all in, you know, at my uncle's house, and he says that his music is jazz. He says, I love jazz. He says that the blues, jazz. He says, that's a style of music I play. He says, and I always try to incorporate that with my accordion. And that's why I came up with this unique style. Cause I try to put in some jazz and he says, I mean, I made it, you know, it's just a honer, man. It's just a small little box. And he came up with this, you know, made it sound. When he was invited to Germany to go perform in the festival, the accordion festival in Germany, something big, accordionists from throughout the world go out there and they perform. They do what they're known for. And Esteban was invited to attend there. And he says that when he shows up with the, he says, I show up with this little box, you know, hanging out off my neck, and one of the guys that works for Horner says, are you ready? He says, yeah. And he's looking around and he says, is that what you're going to play with? And he says, well, yeah, this is what I play with, man. This is my accordion. He says, oh, man. He says, I've never seen you perform. I only have heard you play. But the way you sound is like you have this giant chromatic accordion, yeah, like, and all
like,
that.
Like a chromatic.
Yeah. Yeah,
either a key, he says, a key he or, sa- or a button chromatic.
Exactly. He says, how in the world do you make this little owner? He says, to us here in Germany, this accordion that you're playing, to us is just equivalent to a harmonica.
He right. says, it's just for easy folk.
Yeah,
music.
You know, you go into your garage and you play it. I mean, just for hanging out with your buddies there. But how do you make it sound that way? And Jordan, Steve says that
four note voicings.
Yeah, he says, I looked at them and I said, hey, man, you know what? You guys make it. I just play it, man. and so he says he went on stage and then he showed me the paper clippings of, and well, it was in German. I didn't, but he was saying that, like, wow, man, this guy from Texas, Esteban Jordan, he says, finally got to meet him, and because they heard a lot about him, so much so that of course they had a signature accordion in his name, and even then he'd say, "Now, bro, I'm still learning. You never stop learning the accordion."
Yep, I'm
still
learning.
Wow. I said, "Wow." I said, "What else can you make it do, Steve?" He says, "Well, you know what? I already made a talk." I go, "What?" He says, oh, yeah. He says, the other day I had it say chingao. I started laughing, man. I go, really? He goes, yeah, man. And it's just the way you press the button and squeeze it, and you can make it talk, man. I said, wow, yeah. Man. But, yeah, that was interesting.
No, his musical choices, too. I saw him at Rosedale. I think that was the same year, like 2005 or 4 or something. And he played Set Me Free, Why Don't You, Babe?
Yeah.
By that Motown group. Diana Ross, what was that group? The Supremes.
Yeah.
And I was like, what? Man, like, his musical concept is just really was it's just different.
Let's go with Swinging Doors.
Swinging Doors, oh yeah, the country. This and then he, like, when he did the verses in Spanish, right? And I thought that was cool.
You're tuned in to DJ Alacran right here on TejanoTimes.com. We're interviewing Elliot Verbo, Molio y su conjunto, Swinging Doors. Check it out.
To let you know where I'll be living. It's not much, but I feel. And I've got swinging doors, a jukebox, and a bar stool. My new home has a flashy neon sign. Supper and see me anytime you want to. Cause I'm a closing time. Esta pena que yo tengo me trae. Stop by
Molillo y su conjunto, Elliot Faribo, El Güerito. This is a bad dude. This guy's a bad dude, man. He's a talented musician, plays different instruments. I love his music. Puro Califas in the house. Qué bárbaro. No, mira, let me ask you this question. Bolillo y su conjunto. I think I have a pretty good idea as to why Bolillo. Because you're a white boy.
Right. White bread.
The white Bolillo, man.
That was someone who was talking to me in San Antonio. And they were like, hey, Bolillo, like, what are you doing hanging out with all these Chicanos over here, man?
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, that's good.
Yeah.
Bolillo. I was like, that's the nickname for me. You know,
yeah.
I was like, my band's gonna be called Elliot Barabo. Like, come on, like my name is just like, you know, most people can't even pronounce it. So,
hey, bro. So Barabo, your last name, it's what, French?
Yeah, that's a French last name, but yeah. I'm not French. My father was adopted.
Oh, I see.
So that was the name of the family that adopted him.
Oh, I see.
I'm Polish.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, my grandmother.
You know, so you're connected to the accordion, man. I mean, the roots.
I guess, like, culturally, like, de sangre, but it's not like they were like, here, play the accordion when I was growing up. I mean, my uncle played the clarinet and my mom played the piano, but it was more like they wanted to play, like, I think my uncle played in a polka band, but, you know, that's a different kind of polka. It's
it was
not
different.
Really like,
it was different.
It's was not different. Like, you know, it has no like rhythmic intensity to it like conjunto music does.
No, but you know, and they played. I think one time that I saw this video where they took some Flaco Jimenez polkas and they showed them to polka stars in Germany and Holland and all that, and they were like, nah, I don't think that's not the style, and you know, they didn't have nothing positive to say, and so he says, yeah, but they took it from you guys, and he says, yeah, but they changed it. Well, yeah, they did. I mean, Marraza right here, the music initially, when they used to listen to these umpa bands, back in the day, and my raza, the Latinos, started congregating around these people, saying, "Man, you know what? It appealed to them. The music, it appealed to them, and they say, 'Sabes qué? Let me try this, man. But what if we do it like this, man? How about if we do it like this and give it some heart, some sabor, some alegría?"
Exactly.
And this we have it now. Mira, Bolillo, I would hate to tell you that I got to go to do other things, and I would hate to let you go because I'm enjoying the conversation that I'm having with you. You've had a lot of good stories, and definitely not going to be the last time. I'm gonna bring you back, and we're gonna continue with some stories and more music.
Thank you, Alacran, and just wanted to say thank you. I'm humbled to even be, you know, part of this conversation at all. Like to be mentioned in the same breath as all these other great, you know, Tejano and Conjunto players. Just wanted to just say hello and say thank you and give a shout out to some people who have always supported me and been on my side and just the people that believe in me. And Joyce Trevino, yes. First of all, thank you so much. Conjunto Ben, thank you. Lorenzo Martinez, thank you so much. And Jaime Saenz from Bordertown.
Yes, sir.
And I don't know. There's so many people that I want to say thank you to. I'll just leave it there at those four for right now.
Well, you got a lot of people that are following you that are really, really big fans of Elliot Bearable Conjunto.
Thank you. Wow. I mean,
and
it's hard for me to believe, you know what I mean?
And I'm talking about fans from Texas where the La Mera Mata is in Conjunto music, and yet they're enjoying the music. And I mean, and it's understandable why. I mean, you know, it's not, you play good, I mean, solid Conjunto music. You know what? And before I leave, I was gonna tell you this. Or ask you about this. I seen you many years ago, bro, and I didn't even know who you were. And I saw you one day. I was home, and I turned on the TV, and I'm a big fan. I was a big fan of California's Gold.
Oh yes.
You know what I mean? And so I.
Oh my God.
And I was. And there's this, what was his name? The host,
Huell Howser.
Yes, sir.
That's amazing.
And he was interviewing some musicians and there you were, man, playing the accordion. Am I correct?
I was playing Bajo Sexto.
Okay.
Antonio, Lorenzo, it was me, Lorenzo and Antonio. I think Lorenzo was there with his, Huasteca.
Okay.
Like that. It's like mariachi music, but.
Yes, yes.
All wapangos and stuff. I don't know the style of music.
And Huell interviewed you. He talked to you for a little bit, and I go, wow. You know what? And I saw that episode back in the day, but I never realized it was you until you mentioned it many years later.
Many pounds ago.
Yeah, and I said, "Whoa, wait a second! I remember that. I seen it because I was. Till this day. I mean, I know that he passed away, but there's a lot of reruns on our local community channel here.
Huell. I want to give a shout out to Huell. I want to give a shout out to Jacob Hernandez of Guadalupe Custom Strings. That's where the show was. He's still selling strings. He makes all the right strings for Texas players, the brass, bronze for bajo sexto, and the cobre, the red. He makes the red copper ones.
Okay.
And man, that was great. I want to give a shout out to Norma Garza and. They were like the first people up there at KPFK to play Los Pochos and.
Wow. No, pues let me tell you something. Definitely, it's not going to be the last time that I'm going to get you on. Mi casa es su casa.
Oh, thank you.
And we'll get you back on so we can continue with this conversation. Otherwise, we can be here all freaking afternoon talking about it. Exactly. So, okay, carnalito, you know what? You might be. I had a good friend. He was white. He was Irish, but he was also married to a Latina. And he's the same, man, bro. Yeah, my skin is white, but my heart, my soul is brown, brother. Man.
Nice.
His name was Billy B. Oliver, man. And so he says, yeah, my skin might be white, bro, but my soul is brown, man. Man, rest in peace. He was one of my great friends. Pero órale, bro, pues ahí estamos. And you know what? We'll definitely get you back. Thank you so much for your time, for hanging out on my show. And
thanks for having me.
Yeah, no problem, man. I mean, the honor was mine. And I got you. And gracias, thanks for the shout-outs, and thanks for the drop, and I'll definitely be putting it to good use.
Okay. Orale, stay dry, have a good day.
Eso. Ahora vámonos con Jambalaya, bro.
Pirogue down the bayou. My Yvonne, this is Elliot from Bolio y su Conjunto. You're listening to DJ Alacran on Tejano Times Radio. Shoot it!
Because tonight I'm gonna see my shadow meal. The guitar, fill a food job, and be gay. Son of a gun, we'll have big fun down on Dubai. Is buzzing. Kinfolk come to see Yvonne by the dozen. Dress in style, go hog wild, me oh my, oh. Son of a gun, we'll have big fun down on Dubai. Tonight I'm gonna see my shower meal. Pick a top, fill a fruit jar, and be gay. Son of a gun, we'll have big fun down on the bayou.
You are listening to my favorite DJ, DJ Alacran on TejanoTimes.com.
DJ Alacran.
Sí, señor, quiero que sepas cómo está toda mi clica. Love you guys. I hope you guys enjoyed this interview with Elliot Variable. Bolio y su conjunto. Great guy, great friend, my compadre. Gracias por being in the show. Y ahora vámonos.
Lo mejor de la onda tejana. TejanoTimes.com.